Claire Phoenix here at Food Ingredients Europe. I'm here with Jason Hecker. He's Vice President Global Marketing for Pure Circle in the USA. Jason, can you tell me how stevia is being used in beverages and in foods, and what's the percentage of market awareness?
Yeah, absolutely. So first of all, in this past year, almost 200 products, high purity stevia products, have launched around the world. That's food and beverages and markets around the world that contain stevia. So significant growth year over year. And you can find that across a wide gamut of types of products, from carbonated soft drinks to teas to powdered soft drinks to dairy beverages targeted at zero calorie to reformulated and reduced to focused on kids to women for dieting. So we're really seeing a mainstream penetration of stevia. You know, the expectation is for much more growth over the coming years.
And what's awareness like, States?
Yeah, because of the market right now and all the dynamics that are driving it, from obesity and diabetes to the natural trends, the pickup and awareness of stevia in the media, as well as exposure to all these products I'm talking about, has really driven growth. Nearly, in the U.S., 62% of the U.S. population, the general population, is already aware of stevia. In France, it's grown to nearly 50% mm-hmm. in just 2 years. And we've been tracking this awareness across markets around the world, and it's growing at similar rates.
In Europe, we've only just had acceptance. It's November 14th, so it's very early days here, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. And, we've got that data, too. We've done market research through our Pure Circle Insights group across Spain, Germany, France, the U.K., to China, to Mexico. I can tell you right now, the U.K., as well as in Spain, because it just got approved, awareness is about 10% general population. But compare that to France. Last year, awareness of stevia was about 23%. This year, 47%. It's tremendous rapid growth, and it's because of all of the pickup in the media, because of obesity and diabetes, and the range of products and tabletop that have launched and really talk about stevia, because the idea of talking about this plant, this natural plant, really resonates with consumers and drives awareness very quickly.
Mm-hmm. I mean, a number of companies here at Food Ingredients Europe are claiming to own the supply chain. How would you respond to that?
Yeah, well, I'd say first the most important thing is when we talk to our customers, ask to audit a supply chain. We encourage, and our largest customers in the world, they come out and they audit it. They actually come out and they come to our purification facility that we own, the largest in the world. They come to our extraction facility that we own, the largest in the world. They come to the farms and meet the farmers in Paraguay and Kenya and in China, and they can see the work that we're doing on developing proprietary varieties of leaf. The only way to know is to truly audit, but what we'd say is you just have to ask the right questions. There's a difference between controlling your supply chain and owning it, to managing it, to buying extract from somebody else that supplies it in another market. And, we pride ourselves being the leading company in the market that truly owns and controls its supply chain. And it's been critical to our ability to innovate, to scale the industry, and to drive innovation.
Yes, people are always concerned about consistency of supply, aren't they? But they're also concerned about sustainability, particularly the retailers. How do you respond to this one?
Yeah, it's critical. We look at trends in Data Monitor and Mintel of products that have launched, and more products are being launched with natural environmental claims on them. It's important to consumers. It's important to retailers. And frankly, it's important to scale an industry. You can't these days scale an industry if you're doing it in an unsustainable way. So it goes back to your question on really controlling and owning your supply chain. Because we do that, we can talk about, for example, our extraction facility. At that facility, we've got a water treatment plant that helps us to recycle and return water in clean form back to the environment. We've got a biomass to biogas facility, because there is leaf biomass waste after you extract the sweetness from the leaf. And what do you do with that? You can use it for fertilizer, but we also turn it into electricity, and enough electricity to power nearly 75% of what we use in our extraction facility. So these stories are important, but they're also social stories around sustainability. We invest in microfinance lending so that farmers can get the capital in developing markets to be able to buy these seedlings and have the materials to actually grow stevia. And these are stories that are important to consumers as they are to retailers. And
how many farmers do you work with?
We work with over 60,000 farmers around the world, and we've got, there's a big base in China that's helped to really help support the base in Japan, which is really where the history of stevia has developed over the years. But we own facilities within Paraguay and Kenya for years that we've been actively developing and are looking to scale as the industry scales. In the U.S., we've been working with S&W Seed Company, which is a phenomenal agricultural company, to help develop large-scale farming in that market. We've talked about the base of growers that we've worked with over four continents.
But it's the farmers then that own the land and they own the seedlings, so you're just accessing that.
Yeah, I mean, truly, we want to work with farmers that grow multiple different crops on their land. It's very important for the diversification in the land, as well as these are often, low-income people that we're helping to support with this crop, because they truly can make a better income with stevia than pretty much most anything else that they can grow on that land. So what our role is with the farmers is we recruit them, we train them, we develop our own proprietary varieties of our leaf, we grow the seedlings, we work with them, we give microfinance lending in conjunction with banks so that they can actually buy seedlings, as well as many of them have started to create their own nurseries to sell on themselves, so it's a very sustainable practice, and then we contract with them and buy them back.
So
when
is there
they're
a
done.
Crop rotation? Is there another crop grown different years to keep the soil quality?
Yeah, it depends on the market. In some of these markets, you can get multiple yields per year in Paraguay and in Kenya. But on that land, they grow multiple things. I mean, the nice thing about stevia is because it's a high-intensity sweetener, you can get quite a lot of sweetness off of a small quantity.
Yes.
So that they have the ability to diversify, grow other crops that feed their family, as well as growing stevia, which is very important not only for the land, but also for their families.
Local community. Yep, great. Thank you very much, Jason.
My pleasure.
Thanks again for downloading this podcast. For more news, analysis, opinion, interviews, and multimedia for the food and beverage industry, go to foodbev.com.